You're at the cutting edge of cardiovascular sciences. I'm John Cooke, professor and chair of the Department of Cardiovascular Sciences here at Houston Methodist. And with me in the studio is Dr. Lee Lai, a junior faculty member in our Department of Cardiovascular Sciences. And she's going to be introducing our guest, Dr. Dan Roden.
Good morning, everyone. Today it's my great honor to introduce our speaker, Dr. Dan Roden. So Dr. Dan Roden is a professor of medicine, pharmacology, and biomedical informatics. He's also the senior vice president for personalized medicine at Vanderbilt University School of Medicine. Dr. Roden received his medical training and degree in internal medicine at McGill University in Canada. After he finished fellowship in clinical pharmacology and cardiology, he then joined the faculty at Vanderbilt University. He served as Chief of Division of Clinical Pharmacology at Vanderbilt University for 12 years. Then he started to lead Vanderbilt's effort in personalized medicine. His research program studies how genetic variants affect human disease susceptibility, and his special interests are pharmacogenetics and the genetic determinants of normal heart rhythms, especially those induced by drugs. So today it's our great honor to have Dr. Roden in our show, and looking forward to your talk.
Dan, thanks for joining us this morning, and looking forward to your talk. But I thought before you launch into next-gen human genomics and its significance for cardiovascular disease, perhaps you could tell us a little bit about yourself and your career. But welcome to our show.
Well, thanks, Jen. You know, I don't want to take up the entire hour talking about my career, but I've been just very lucky to be in the right place at the right time for my particular attitudes and background. As I was telling you earlier, I grew up in Canada, and in Canada you finish medical school at a little bit earlier than you do in the States. I also skipped a year in school, so I was even younger than average. And the other thing that happens in Canada is you come out with no debt. So I had finished training in medical school. I'd finished internal medicine residency. I had really done very, very little, actually no research at all, but I thought I would spend a year or so doing something called clinical pharmacology. I had done an elective in clinical pharmacology at residency, and it would make me into a better doctor, learning about drug interactions, learning about pharmacokinetics. And so I ended up at Vanderbilt, which is a research-intensive institution. I ended up with a mentor, Ray Woosley, who was a young faculty member working on new antiarrhythmic drugs. We were talking earlier about how late 70s, early 80s was an era when we were developing lots of new antiarrhythmic drugs and trying to understand whether they were good or bad for patients. And sometimes they're good and sometimes they're bad. And learning about pharmacokinetics, learning about drug interactions, learning about pharmacogenetics. It turns out some of the drugs I was studying were pharmacogenetics drugs. I trained in cardiology here because I told myself, if I'm going to be giving antiarrhythmic drugs to patients for a lifetime, I better learn how to take care of patients with heart disease. And I love clinical medicine and I love clinical cardiology. And my research career sort of paralleled the kinds of advances that people have had over the years, looking at things like along comes the ability to clone ion channels. So learn how to clone ion channels. Along comes the ability to do electrophysiologic studies on single cells or tissues, and I learned how to do that. And along comes genetics, and it turns out genetic variation in ion channel genes causes human diseases, and along comes that. And now I have a clinic where all I see are patients with genetic heart diseases, and we do a lot of research, some of which I'm going to talk about in the talk, on trying to understand the implications of variants in cardiac ion channel genes. And of course, I still have a finger in the pharmacogenetics community, so I'm spending a lot of time thinking about how to implement pharmacogenetics and genetic medicine in general. So I've sort of wandered through a career in molecular medicine and translational medicine, and
Wonderful story.
It was all an accident, and I couldn't have asked for a better career path.
Wonderful story. And I wonder, did your father was a general practitioner. How did that influence your career?
Well, I knew he was a doctor, and I, as I was telling you earlier, he had an office where, I mean, he would deliver babies, he would do general surgery, he would set broken bones, he had an X-ray machine in his office, and I knew he did all those things. But I really, you know, we the dinner table conversation wasn't around medicine. It was around a lot of other things, and but I knew that that existed. I remember very vividly. Accompanying him to, he was on holiday, and they had rented a house north of Montreal for a couple of weeks, and he had told a patient that if she was going to deliver, he would even come down to Montreal and deliver her, even though he was on holiday. And I drove down to Montreal one evening with him so he could deliver this young woman's baby, and I was waiting in the waiting room with, you know, with the expected fathers, and he came out, and he was dressed in scrubs and covered in blood because he had just delivered a baby. And I thought to myself, I had no idea that he would dress up like that. I had no idea that, you know, childbirth was such a messy procedure. So I really wasn't exposed much to medicine as a dinner table conversation or anything like that. But he, I have to think that, you know, the idea that medicine is a career to help people and, you know, had some influence on me in my choice of careers. I was telling you earlier that I think I went into medicine to help people and to, you know, apply my scientific background and my math background to interesting problems. So my initial idea was to be, I don't know what my initial idea was. I know that I had, when I came to medical school, I had no preconceptions about the kind of medicine I would do. And if somebody had told me I would be doing what I do now, I think I would have told them they were crazy.
Was there a mentor that you had, Dan, that influenced your direction?
Well, I think the environment, you know, I came to Vanderbilt as a fellow, and I've been here ever since. And some people say, well, you know, you're just too lazy to move. And I've, you know, I've looked at other positions around. And every time I think about how my career evolved, it's the mentoring environment here. My first mentor, Ray Woosley, was a huge influence on me. But I had many mentors along the way, many colleagues who were very generous in you know, teaching me things and helping me advance to the next kind of career and next kind of science. But the opportunity to go from doing the clinical pharmacology of a new antiarrhythmic drug to understanding the underlying electrophysiology, to understanding the underlying molecular mechanisms, to understanding the genetic variation, all of that was lots of people in the environment who were willing to sort of help me take the next step. I mean, we have a huge investment in our electronic health record, and I've been, you know, fortunate to be part of that since the very beginning. And I think that it's just the environment that has been hugely helpful. But obviously, there were a couple of really, really important mentors. Ray was certainly one, and there were many, many others that I'll just leave it at that. Obviously, that, you know, it's sort of, you're doing something that you enjoy. You have the ability to learn new things and apply them to solving interesting problems. That was really, really appealing to me. I will say this, I think to have a successful career like mine has been, or like many other people have been, you really have to put in the time. I spent 2 years as a clinical pharmacology fellow, and that is not nearly enough to make you an independent scientist. Yeah. And I trained in cardiology, and then I came back as a faculty member in Clin Pharm, and I spent the next 4 or 5 years sitting at the same desk that I had sat at as a fellow, being paid not very much, but being paid as a faculty member and being expected to be a faculty member, but I was still in training. So I had, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 years literally at the bench learning things. I was fortunate to be a faculty member during much of that, but that was a, I would call it a kinder, gentler time. But I think it's really important that people understand that this is the term is lifelong learning, and mm-hmm. it really is lifelong learning, but you have to put in a lot of time at the beginning to sort of get good at the basics.
Well, we're going to drill down into your research in just a moment, but you mentioned the environment at Vanderbilt, and I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about how you're creating an environment there for personalized medicine. You're responsible for the personalized medicine program now at Vanderbilt. So tell us a little bit about the program and the environment there that you're creating.
No, I wish you'd asked me to talk about that instead of the other topic. But I came to Vanderbilt because it was an excellent place for clinical pharmacology, the science of trying to understand why not everybody responds to drug therapy in the same way. And part of that is a genetic story. The other thing that Vanderbilt, and Vanderbilt is a world leader, has always been a world leader in that. The other thing that Vanderbilt made an early investment in because of, you know, really, really thoughtful leadership was in biomedical informatics. So we hired one individual in 1990 whose mission was to create a blueprint for how biomedical informatics would grow. And he did that. And biomedical informatics is now a department that has over 150 faculty members. Wow. We had an investment in an electronic record very, very early. By the year 2000, I was going to clinic and I was not holding a manila folder in my hand anymore. So those two things together, if you think about it, those are the things that really, you know, conspire to make us think about think about personalizing medicine. I remember, I tell people this story. I was walking to work one day. I lived close enough that I would walk. It was a beautiful fall day. And I thought to myself, well, you've been doing clinical pharmacology for two decades now. You know all about the genetics of variable drug responses, but no clinician in his right mind uses any of that information. And the reason is that it's a pain in the rear to implement, because you have to tell the patient, I'm going to give you a drug, but I'm going to do a genetic test, and I'm going to say, well, you know, if the genetic test turns out awkward, I'm going to call you in a week or two, say, well, you know, I chose the wrong dose or I chose the wrong drug, and we'll change it. And that's just not a reasonable way to practice medicine. So I thought, well, with the electronic health record and with this revolution in genomics that is just starting, maybe the way to do that is to pre-genotype everybody and stick the stuff in their electronic record and then have it there to be used when the time comes. So that was the original vision. I wrote that in a letter to my CEO at the medical center. I got summoned to his office and he said, yeah, we need, and I said in the letter, I said, in order to do that, we need a biobank. And so he said, go build a biobank and figure out how to do that. And that was in the, you know, that was 15, almost 20 years ago now. And so we have a very large biobank. We've learned how to use the electronic health record. And there are two parts to that. One is discovering new things. And we've done our fair share of that. And the other is figuring out how to use that information to actually personalize care. And we're starting to do that as well. In the pharmacogenetic space, we've had a program in preemptive pharmacogenetic testing for about 13 years now. We started in 2010, and we're thinking hard about how to use genetics to, in my clinic, you know, everybody's had genetic testing because they all come with for a genetic arrhythmia syndrome. So they either get genetic testing in our clinic or they come with their genetic test results, often, you know, with a large family. So I think that, you know, the way in which we're using genetic information to personalize care is you know, is a coming thing. That's one of the things I'll talk about. And you know, the oncologists are way ahead of us. Turns out, you know, cancer is a disease of the genome, and knowing the genetic basis of a particular cancer makes people smarter about how to treat that cancer. And I hope that, you know, when we look at patients with dilated cardiomyopathy or with atrial fibrillation or with, you know, more obscure diseases like long QT syndrome, that we use genetic information to actually guide therapy and improve treatment. And of course, you know, and the granddaddy of all those things, I think, well, I shouldn't say the granddaddy, but the common diseases in our space, you know, are familial hypercholesterolemia and cardiomyopathies. And I think we need to do a much better job of finding those patients early and doing preemptive treatments.
Wonderful. Well, we're going to start drilling down into that with your presentation. But before we do, I just want to remind our audience that you can join us for questions in the discussion period by calling 37607 and texting DeBakey. So Basically, text DeBakey to 37607, joining us by text. Alternatively, if you're at your computer, you can go to pollev.com. That's pollev.com, and enter DeBakey. That's DeBakey, and that'll get you into the discussion. Well, Dan, let's hear your talk on next-gen genomics.
Okay, let me share my screen, which we know works. And I'm not sure why I chose this particular title, or maybe it was given to me, but there it is. And this is one aspect of genomic medicine, which I think is going to be an increasing problem until we solve it. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to outline a little bit about genomic medicine and what I mean by that term, and then I'm going to introduce the idea of a variant of unknown significance and describe why it's a big problem, and then describe what we're doing to try to solve that problem. So let's see if I can change my slide. So genomic medicine is not the idea that you know, people vary in their response to disease is not a new one. This is a quote from Hippocrates: more important to know what sort of a person has a disease than to know what sort of disease a person has. That's long, long time ago. In the 1850s, the monk Mendel was doing experiments on pea plants and defined the rules of inheritance as we understand them today. This is a person who many of you may not know, but I have a background in pharmacogenetics. Archibald Garrard was the dean of the medical school at Oxford, the Regius Professor of Medicine at Oxford, and he outlined the idea that maybe variability in response to drugs was similar to variability in certain kinds of diseases that he was studying. He's famous for studying inborn errors of metabolism, diseases like alkaptonuria, or even just, you know, things like that, where you don't metabolize some endogenous substrate. And he said, well, maybe people don't metabolize exogenous substrates, and maybe that's part of the problem with variable drug responses. So he's credited with that. And of course, Watson and Crick, by identifying the structure of DNA in the early 1960s, outlined the way in which genetic information can be transferred from one cell to another, from one person to another, by outlining the double helix and saying, well, the double helix can unzip and make a copy of itself. And there's this wonderful line in their Nature paper in 1963, for which they won the Nobel Prize, that says exactly that, that they've now, you know, it's not escaped our attention that this could provide a mechanism for inheritance. So fast forward to the 1970s, and it became possible to sequence DNA. This is a very, very old method of sequencing using radioactivity, and nobody does that anymore, thank goodness. In 1983, one of the huge advances in understanding how to do genetics came with the development of something called the polymerase chain reaction, PCR. That's how you amplify a single molecule of DNA into many, 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 many copies, rendering it available for analysis of various kinds. And the other really huge advance in the 1980s, which I don't think people sort of credit for the genome revolution, is the development of personal computers and development of intense computational abilities. So once you have the ability to compute, then you can have the ability to store very large amounts of genetic information and share it across many, many labs. And that's what the Human Genome Project, which ran for 20 years, did. They developed sequences and they shared sequences, and that's how we assembled the first human genome. In the 20 years ago, people started to understand that there were variations in the human genome. The commonest kind of variant is something called a single nucleotide polymorphism, one letter that's changed from an A to a T or an A to a G or whatever. And those are called SNPs. And the NIH started to keep track of SNPs in public databases, and the 10 millionth SNP was recorded in 2005 or so at a resource called NCBI. There's a resource that anybody can go to on the web called NOMAD, the Genomic Aggregation Database, and they post what they see as variation in all the genes that we have in almost 200,000 coding regions, mostly exomes, some genomes. And I'm part of a program called All of Us, and all of us has posted 245,000 whole genome sequences for public browsing. And in that sequence, there are over a billion SNPs. So we've come a long way, and we have a lot longer way to go to fully define the variation of the human genome. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. This is Gordon Moore, who founded Intel and famously founded Moore's Law. And Moore's Law says that the computational power in your personal computer or in your desktop computer or in your telephone now increases by a factor of 2 every 12 to 18 months. And this is his way of demonstrating that, looking at integrated circuits and various PCs. I started to get into this business sort of in here somewhere. So we're now up here now. The way Moore's Law applies to genome sequencing is that if the first genome cost about $3 billion, and if you did a second one right away, the estimate was it would have cost $100 million. So if Moore's Law says the cost of computing should drop by a factor of 2 every 12 to 18 months, and so this is the way it should drop over time. And that's the way it dropped over time for the first 6 or 7 years after the first human genome draft was announced. And then along comes next generation sequencing, new technology, cost plummets, and then stays plateaued, and then plummets again, stays plateaued. And now it is totally expected that you can do a whole genome sequence for way under $1,000. I remember people agonizing over the $1,000 genome, but now it's a couple of $100s at most, and it'll drop further even. So because of that, we have the ability to start applying the human genome and genetic variation to lots of different parts of medicine. This is a woman who's asking the pharmacist to do something clever with her sequence, presumably a manifestation of pharmacogenetics. We are part of something called the Undiagnosed Diseases Network, where people who have these diagnostic odysseys because they have very, very strange combinations of symptoms and signs undergo genome sequencing, and diagnoses are made in somewhere between a third and a half of patients who end up in the Undiagnosed Disease Network. And we have an Undiagnosed Disease Network clinic now here. Sick neonates are now often sequenced, and the record is 7 hours from getting a blood sample to a first draft of an annotated whole genome sequence. Sometimes that helps in terms of making a diagnosis. That means that the child should, it's futile to take care of the child, and you should just let the child have comfort care. Other times, specific treatments are invented. Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter had metastatic melanoma to the brain. And in any other era, Jimmy Carter would long since have been dead. But he got immune checkpoint inhibitors, and he is still alive in his 98th year. And I mentioned the idea of familial hypercholesterolemia before. These are xanthelasma, typical of familial hypercholesterolemia. We need to find those patients early and treat them early before they get xanthelasma and before they get coronary artery disease at a very young age. And treatment really does prevent late complications of FH. So that's a little bit of history about genomic medicine and where we are and where we're going. This is a specific case. This is an 11-year-old who had a witnessed cardiac arrest on the first day at a new school. His first rhythm was VF, and he had an AED shock times 2 and came to. No relevant family history. And I just will pause to say that this story was not possible to present when I started in biomedicine 20 or 30 or 40 years ago. It's only with the development of AEDs and an educated population that this child survived. This is his electrocardiogram. I could spend hours talking about his ECG. He has a long QT interval, and that's probably part of his problem. We do in-house genetic testing. We did in-house genetic testing. And he has two variants of uncertain significance in a gene called calmodulin 2. Now, when you get a result of a variant of uncertain significance, that means we really don't know whether that variant causes this disease or not. Now, variants in calmodulin 2 are known to be causes of long QT and other related arrhythmia syndromes, but just because you see a variant in a patient who has a phenotype that might make sense doesn't mean the variant caused the phenotype. We've learned that the hard way by making the assumption that the variant causes the disease, then treating family members, and it turns out the treatment for the family members is unnecessary because the variants turned out to be benign. So we really don't know what to do with variants of uncertain significance. They don't help us in diagnosis, and they don't help us take care of families. We're not supposed to use this information to take care of families. So the problem is that we have a child who's ill, and we don't know what to tell the family. So the American College of Medical Genetics and Genomics, ACMG, has come out with a very, very complicated framework, which I am not going to walk you through, including criteria for population data, computational data, functional data, segregation with disease or not, other database information, all the stuff that you see down here. But one of the interesting things is that if you can do an in vitro functional test, that is, you know, you express it in some cellular system, and you can show that something is benign or deleterious, then that helps you in terms of moving something from being a variant of uncertain significance to either being benign or pathogenic. So here's the problem. One of the genes that we study in my lab a lot is SCN5A, encodes the cardiac sodium channel. But this is just an example. So in the cardiac sodium channel, there are almost 1,400 variants that have been reported. The gene itself is 2,000, the protein itself is 2,016 amino acids long. So there's lots more variants that could be happening. And out of those 1,300 or 1,400 variants, 190 are likely pathogenic based on the criteria that I showed you in that complicated slide just a second ago, and 91 are probably benign. So the vast number of variants that we see in the cardiac sodium channel, we don't know whether they're benign or pathogenic. Now, that seems like a big problem, and there's lots of variants that need to be studied, but it actually is much worse than that. So one of my colleagues, Fritz Roth, who's in Toronto, made this what he calls the simple back-of-the-envelope calculation. Given the size of the human population and how frequently people develop a mutation from generation to generation, and how big the human genome is, he estimates that there are 51 people on the face of the planet who carry every single missense variant is carried by an average of 51 people, except for the ones that are embryo lethal. So that means that we should expect the human genome is 3 billion base pairs. There should be 9 billion possible SNPs. And each of those should be represented 51 times across the genome. So the human genome is very, very diverse, but we should expect every variant to be present. So this is the slide I showed you before, but the real problem is that if every variant in the cardiac sodium channel were, every variant in the coding region of the cardiac sodium channel were represented, we'd have to deal with 38,000 variants. Now, many of those haven't been reported yet, but as we sequence more and more people across the globe, we will start to see variants, and this number will actually be the number of variants that will be reported eventually. So the National Human Genome Research Institute, which is the institute that the forerunner was the Human Genome Project, has a strategic vision that was published in 2020. They had a bold prediction for human genomics by 2030. And one of the bold prediction was that the clinical relevance of all encountered genomic variants will be readily predictable, rendering the diagnostic designation variant of uncertain significance, or VUS, obsolete. So how are you going to solve that problem? So we're going to use a lot of computational power, and eventually we're going to marry function to artificial intelligence to be able to predict whether a variant is going to be bad or not. And we're getting there, but it's slow. And the in silico predictors, the computational predictors, aren't perfect. You can ask the question, do variant carriers actually have a phenotype? And if you have enough variants and enough variant carriers, you can answer that question. You can do that in families, that's traditional genetics, or in populations, in electronic health records or in biobanks, and I'll show you an example of that. And then you can study the variant. So I can take that calmodulin variant and study it in a cellular system, one variant at a time. or I can study many variants at a time, or I can even develop methods to study all possible variants. And I'll show you examples of those in a second. So this is what I call many variants at a time. This is the cardiac sodium channel again, and we studied here 60 or so variants. Some of them were, this is the peak sodium current for wild type, and we set that to 100%. So some of these variants don't look like they affect peak current at all, and we call them benign, and those are our controls. And then here's a set of variants that have been associated with Brugada syndrome, a syndrome of loss of sodium channel function. Some of these variants are very clearly normal, so they're not Brugada syndrome variants. Some of them seem to reduce current by about 50%, and some of them really wipe out current completely. So we think these are probably Brugada syndrome variants. These are likely, and these are not. That's just based, and that's using a technique called patch clamp electrophysiology, but instead of doing it at one cell and one variant at a time, we use an automated patch clamp system, and we can study up to 384 cells at a single sitting. So that allows us to generate data in large numbers of cells, dozens and dozens of cells. And what we did then was we asked the question, well, here's a variant, pick a variant, and say, well, how many times does that variant appear in a population database, in this database called NOMAD that I mentioned earlier? And how many times has it been reported in a patient with Brugada syndrome? So if it appears in a population database a lot, and it's not been in Brugada syndrome in the literature very much, then it's likely to be benign in this assay. If it appears in the literature associated with Brugada syndrome a lot and not very many times in NOMAD, we set the number at 6 here, then it's more likely to be pathogenic. So that's one way of doing it. And we were able to reclassify a large number of variants of uncertain significance as either benign, likely benign, pathogenic, or likely pathogenic. And then we asked the question, what do those do to the predicted structure of the sodium channels? And these are very cool examples. So here's an example. The sodium channel is an ion channel. So it has to conduct sodium ions from one side of a membrane to another. And this is a view of the sodium channel from above. So that's the hole through which sodium has to go. And that's what the wild type channel looks like with the hole in it. And if you put a K instead of an E at residue 901, that blocks up the hole. So that's a loss of function variant. And the structure tells you why. And here's another one where these are alpha helices. And every time you put a proline into an alpha helix, you bend the alpha helix. And those are all pathogenic as well, because the alpha helices are important and they go away. And here's one where we think the mechanism is that there are these two cysteines and they bond to each other, something called a disulfide bridge, which everybody learns about in organic chemistry and then promptly forgets. And I did too, and I had to relearn all this stuff. So when you put an arginine instead of a cysteine at one of these positions, you break that double bond, you disrupt the structure, and you get a loss of function variant. So those are the explanations for some of these loss of function variants. And we're very interested in marrying structure to these functional assays. So we're part of something called the Electronic Medical Records and Genomics Network. And in the Electronic Medical Records and Genomics Network, we did a project where we sequenced 109 of what I'm fond of calling your least favorite genes, genes that cause Mendelian diseases like SCN5A or BRCA1 for breast cancer, sequenced in 25,000 subjects. And we found that about 6% of people had variants that were pathogenic or likely pathogenic in that set, including mostly genes that predispose to cancer or genes that predispose to heart disease or familial hypercholesterolemia, and then a smattering of other things down here, which I'll talk about some other time. So what we did was we took the arrhythmia genes, there were 10 of them, and we asked the question, well, do people who have variants have phenotypes in the electronic record? Well, the first thing you do is you look at the people who don't carry variants. That was about 20,000. And you ask the question, what kind of phenotypes do they have in their electronic record? And about 25% of them have something in their electronic record, something from extreme phenotypes like sudden death or VT to mild phenotypes like bundle branch block or PVCs. So that's no variant. This is what happens when you carry a pathogenic or likely pathogenic variant. And all of those are overrepresented now. they have, there are more cases, particularly cases of severe phenotypes like sudden death or BF. And if you look at patients who have variants of uncertain significance, then they don't seem to be overrepresented compared to these no variant people. So that's at the gene level. But we're interested in knowing what happens at the level of individual variants. So this is a complicated slide, but these are some of the variants that we saw, individual variants that we saw in that study. And you'll notice the numbers are pretty small, 3, 1, 1, 3, this one is 7, 3, 5, not small numbers, and many of them have associated phenotypes. But, you know, this is one out of one, so it's not, you can't take that too seriously. And then what we did was we did some of that high throughput electrophysiology, that 384 cells at a time kind of electrophysiology. These are two genes that we're interested in, a potassium channel gene and SCN5A. And then we took that information and the electronic health record information, integrated them, and were able to reclassify some of the VUSs as pathogenic, some of the VUSs as benign, and most of them stayed the way they were, because we just don't have large numbers of patients. This is 21,000 patients. Databases encompassing hundreds of thousands of patients are now becoming available, and this is one way we're going to solve this problem. So I just want to close with a little sort of view to the future. So this is the way we're going to do the all possible variants problem. So we're going to take a gene or a region of a gene, and what we do is we make every possible mutation in that region. So I've shown you four variants here. This is the wild type, and these are the four variants. And all those other symbols are important, but not for my discussion today. And we put those into a cell system. So these are cells, and now we make sure that the cells express only one variant per cell. There's a good trick to doing that, and we're able to do that. And the other way to do this is to take heart cells, cardiomyocytes, and we've been doing this experiment as well, and use CRISPR editing and make a pool of cells, each expressing a single variant. So you end up with a pool of cells, and then you do something to them. You challenge them with a drug, or you ask the question, you know, which ones get to the cell surface and which ones don't, questions like that. And then you end up with a group of cells here and then a group of cells after the challenge. And then you do next generation sequencing to figure out which cells survived the challenge and which cells didn't. And you display the data as what we call a variant effect map. So this is every single possible amino acid. There would be 21 rows because there are 21 possible amino acids. And this is the amino acid position in the protein. So, and we color code them from gain of function to loss of function. That's sort of what a map looks like in theory, in cartoon form. And we have a consortium that we're part of that is trying to do this experiment for many cardiovascular genes, CardioVar. So this is a potassium channel subunit called KCNE1. And this is what a map looks like. KCNE1 is 129 amino acid protein. And what you can, and these are every single amino acid down the left-hand column here. And what you can see is, for example, doesn't matter what protein, what the residue, oh, I should tell you that the little dots here, I hope you can see the little dots. The little dots are what the wild type channel has in it, what the wild type protein has in it. So that the little dots should be white. This is a trafficking assay. So variants that decrease trafficking are in red, variants that increase trafficking are in blue. And it turns out that no matter what you do, if you put a cysteine in anywhere in this region of the channel, you get increased cell surface expression. Put almost anything in this region of the channel, you increase cell surface expression. On the other hand, you put something in here and you decrease cell surface expression. So we think this is a really interesting way of, number one, figuring out which variants are important, and number two, telling us a little bit about the underlying biology of this particular protein. Obviously, the details are important, and I've skipped over many of them, but the idea, I think, is I hope you can see that the idea is that we're starting to get an understanding of how these proteins actually work by making all these substitutions. This is a little protein, so it only had about 2,500 separate amino acids that are represented here. And I will say that the gray is areas that we didn't get data on. So I'll come back to this case. It turns out that we work in the CardioVar consortium. We have a variant effect map for calmodulin. And this is what the variant effect map looks like. Pathogenic is green, benign is blue. And we look up the two amino acid changes that this 11-year-old boy had, and both of them are pathogenic. And when one is pathogenic, that's bad. When both of them are pathogenic, that's particularly bad. We reported this earlier this year. And so now we're able to tell the family that these are pathogenic, and we're able to screen the rest of the family to see if they have any of the same variants. I will say that this particular boy had two variants, and they were on the same copy of the protein. We knew that. So I just want to say that what I've spent my time thinking about is what is pathogenic in an in vitro system and what is benign. But what happens in real life, what happens when we take care of patients, is that we ask the question, do they have a disease or not? And even pathogenic variants don't necessarily cause a disease. That's a phenomenon called incomplete penetrance. So people with a variant may have the disease, they may have a very mild manifestation of the disease, or they may have no manifestation at all of the disease. And understanding the mechanisms underlying variable penetrance is going to be another challenge for genomic medicine, because we certainly don't want to start to treat patients who have a pathogenic variant but who have no phenotype and are unlikely to ever get a phenotype. So that's another challenge, which I'm not going to talk about today. I'll just close by saying these are the tools that we're going to have to use to solve the pathogenic problem, pathogenic benign problem, to solve the variant of uncertain significance problem, and to solve eventually the problem of variable penetrance. We're going to need to use studies in families. We're going to need to use advanced computational methods. We're going to need to use large biobanks and electronic health records. And we're going to need to use high throughput function, as I've shown you before. And I want to emphasize that these are all part of a flywheel. And so, you know, what you find in one domain informs what you find in another. So I hope that that has given you some sense of the scope of the variant of uncertain significance problem and what people like us are trying to do to make sure it gets solved so we can implement this vision of genomic or personalized medicine. And I think I'll stop sharing. And
that's a marvelous vision that you're executing on, Dan. Thank you for that wonderful talk. We're going to have a little discussion period now, but before we do, let me just remind again our audience that if they'd like to enter into the discussion, you can text DeBakey to 37607. Just text in your message. Again, that's 37607 and text DeBakey, text in your message. Or you can join by web. Go to polev.com and then enter DeBakey, DeBakey, and you'll be with us. Dan,
I'm getting an error message on my Zoom, and I certainly don't want to close the program. But I hope you can see me or something.
We can see you and we can hear you fine. Lily has Dr. Lai has a question for you.
Actually, my question is: does this genetic variance acquirable? So, will they change over time? Since you are analyzing biobank, it's like, do we need to collect tissue from one patient multiple times?
That's a really interesting question. So, I remember when we set up our biobank 15 years ago, I remember my partner in doing this was the physical informatics. And I remember saying the beauty of studying DNA is that, you know, the DNA that you're born with is the DNA you die with. And he said to me, well, you know, are you sure? And I said, well, you know, that's the dogma. And of course, he was right and I was wrong. There's a lot of interest in this idea that as we age, we acquire somatic mutations. That has been a big deal in the cancer world and in something called clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential or CHIP. And so there are people who are very interested in looking at DNA over time, particularly in white cells, because there's this idea that as people accumulate mutations over time as they age, then that predisposes to myelodysplastic syndrome, various forms of leukemia, and there's certainly a very strong association with coronary artery disease as well. So we haven't got to the point where we're collecting a lot of different samples. We get all our DNA from either spit samples for the genetic testing clinically, or from blood samples. What we don't do is we don't get a cardiac biopsy and ask the question, is there a difference between the cardiac biopsy and the what we see in the blood? Because that would tell you that there are mutations that are occurring in the heart, but not across the body. So the easy answer is you get DNA once and that's your DNA. The more complicated and nuanced and probably much more correct answer is that we don't actually know, but the current practice, leaving aside the chip issue, the clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential, most people would say you collect the data DNA once and that's sufficient to manage these families, for example. But there's certainly a school of thought that says, well, maybe we ought to think about collecting samples over and over again. So that's the complicated answer, but I think the correct answer at this point.
Just a follow-up question on the somatic mutations on CHIP, clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential. You've mentioned that it's also the CHIP is also associated with coronary artery disease, and that's an interesting association. And I wonder if you could tell us what you think is responsible for that association with coronary artery disease.
I'm a layman when it comes to that, but I my impression has been that when we think about coronary artery disease, when I was growing up, it was just a matter of how much cholesterol you managed to get into your coronary artery and whether the plaque was soft or hard and whether it broke and got platelets to stick to it. But I think what we understand now is that there's a complicated biology in the generation of plaques that certainly involves white cell function or various white cell function lines like macrophages and monocytes, and the idea that their function could be changed by a clonal hematopoiesis event and therefore predisposed to coronary artery disease. I think that's probably one possibility, but I this is not my area of expertise, but I think that that's probably the most likely connection. I don't know what you do at Methodist, but at many places, including ours, we're starting to think about creating a CHIP clinic where we see people who have this phenomenon because they've undergone some kind of genetic testing and this happens to be part of their report, and then we follow them.
Interesting. We lost you there for a minute. Hopefully you can hear me. I have a question for you with respect to the patient that you showed us earlier. Returning back to your slide, your talk, you showed us a patient who had this calmodulin SNP, and which was pathogenic for the arrhythmia. Knowing is half the battle, and certainly your approach is giving us an armamentarium toward understanding the pathophysiology. But in this particular case, what did you do for the patient? If you're still with us there, Dan. It seems that we've lost Dr. Roden. Maybe he'll join us in a moment. But the question was with respect to that patient. Perhaps he'll be able to address that in a moment. I had another thought about the talk, and that is, how do you deal with the interactions? I mean, if you have these SNPs that are predictive for a particular arrhythmia.
Sorry.
There, Dan is back with us.
I'm back. I Zoom crashes, once a year, and of course it crashes during this event. I'm sorry.
No worries at all. The question to you, Dan, was about the patient with the calmodulin abnormality.
Right.
I mean, obviously, understanding the battle is understanding the problem is half the battle. But what did you do for that particular patient?
So he's an 11-year-old, and I'm very fond of saying that one of the things that makes my practice really, really easy or simplifies my practice is that I have a partner who is a pediatric electrophysiologist, and who is he takes care of all the kids. So the decisions around what to do with him were driven in, you know, by the pediatric electrophysiology team. Our local expert is a man named Prince Cannon Carroll, and Prince has developed a national reputation as an expert, particularly in this disease. So the calmodulin mutations are interesting because they certainly cause long QT syndrome, and that ECG I showed you has a pretty dramatic and long QT interval. But what was interesting also is when that child was put on a treadmill, he had a lot of polymorphic ventricular ectopy. That's unusual in long QT, and it's much more typical of catecholaminergic polymorphic VT, CPVT, an even more obscure genetic disease. And mutations in calmodulin cause either long QT or CPVT or a hybrid. And so we think he has the hybrid. And so you would say to yourself, he had a cardiac arrest and he should be treated with an ICD. And the exception to that general rule is that patients with CPVT, when you put a defibrillator into them, what happens is they get an event, they get a shock, and then they get a huge adrenaline surge, and they get another shock, and they get a huge adrenaline surge, and they get another shock. And it turns out that the common rhythm that those patients have is something called bidirectional ventricular tachycardia. And that will earn you a shock from your ICD, but it really won't kill you. And what happens, and there have been cases of this, where the shocks from the defibrillator ultimately elicit ventricular fibrillation, but by then the defibrillator has said, well, I've shocked this enough and I'm not going to shock it again. So patients with ICDs can actually die or get into shock storm because of their ICD. So we think aggressive beta blocker therapy and flecainide, a drug that is widely used in CPVT, and some of that goes back to basic science mechanisms and basic science studies in mice that were done at Vanderbilt in a lab right next to mine. So we use flecainide as a standard of therapy, and it's beta blockers are class 1 indication and flecainide is a class 2A indication for CPVT. So that child, I don't think, has a defibrillator, and that would be the reason. So it's complicated, isn't it? Because you have to individualize care, and you would ordinarily say somebody survived a cardiac arrest, man, they better get a defibrillator. But in this particular instance, the defibrillator may not be the right thing.
And following on from that, you have you find a genetic variant in a patient. You mentioned that some individuals have incomplete penetrance, and is part of that incomplete penetrance due to other variants that may be interacting with the pathologic variant?
So there's pretty good data. I know that one of the other lectures that you had in this series was a talk on polygenic risk scores. So polygenic risk scores are this idea that you take many, many variants, each of which is known to affect susceptibility to some disease, let's say coronary artery disease or atrial fibrillation. We could do studies where we identify hundreds or thousands of variants, each one of which contributes a tiny amount to risk. So taken individually, there's no point in even thinking about doing a genetic test. But if you take them all together and ask the question, are there people who have a million variants and each one of those variants predisposes to that disease, then those people will be at high risk for disease. And their data that say that people with high polygenic risk scores for coronary artery disease, for example, they may have risk that's equivalent to patients with a single mutation in that causes familial hypercholesterolemia, so a single mutation in the LDL receptor. So polygenic risk scores are a way of capturing all those other variants. And there's pretty good data now that penetrance, if you look at penetrance for a rare variant and ask the question, so for long QT syndrome, for example, you can do a polygenic risk score for QT interval and say somebody's genetically likely to have a longer QT interval or a shorter QT interval. You can start to see patients who have higher penetrance have longer QT interval, have the rare variant and have a high polygenic risk score for QT. That's early days and early data. We have similar kinds of data for atrial fibrillation, where there are individual variants that appear to predispose, rare variants that appear to predispose to atrial fibrillation, but they're very incompletely penetrant. And it's patients who have the rare variant plus a high polygenic risk score for atrial fibrillation that turn out to have a higher incidence of atrial fibrillation. Early days, I wouldn't want to be, you know, have my feet held to the fire and say that's the explanation. The other possible explanation, of course, is that there are environmental influences that we don't yet fully understand that affect the way a rare variant can behave. But I think that's going to be a next interesting challenge.
I think we have time for one last question. And one of the things that your talk triggered a thought. I was reading that the other day that about 800,000 years ago, the human species got into a bottleneck, and there was only about 1,200 individuals that were present. And we've have all these, 800,000 years later, we have all of these variants. After that period of time, what drives the generation of these variants, do you think? Is it viruses that are driving it, or is it lack of fidelity of the transcription, translation?
It is a miracle that DNA replicates itself over and over and over and over and over again and gets it right just about always. The idea is that you have 30 or so de novo mutations in your genome that you didn't get from your parents. And most of the time, those don't do very much. But occasionally, a de novo, in the cardiac sodium channel, for example, would be a very bad thing for a neonate. So I think it's a random event. I mean, there are some areas of the genome that are more likely to mutate than others. And over the course of hundreds of generations, variants that are well tolerated, can build up. And the other thing is that founder population of, I think the number was 1,700 or something like that, people 800,000 years ago, they were in one place, so they were one population. But then they scattered. And so you might have a one mating pair that goes off somewhere else and then generates new mutations with successive generations. And those mutations aren't seen in the remaining 1,698 people who are left behind. So as populations scatter and as new populations grow up from isolated populations, you'll get lots and lots of mutations. That's why the African genome is much more complicated than any other, because that genome has been around for a longer time and lots of isolated populations. And then you see variants. You see variants, for example, in Asian populations or European ancestry populations that are not seen in African populations, because those variants arose after the migration from Africa. Mm-hmm. So I had to tell you this, Dr. Cooke, but 2% of your genome, 2% of the SNPs in your genome are from your Neanderthal forebears. Mm-hmm. Because there was intermarriage or there were matings between Neanderthals and Homo sapiens. Mm-hmm. But that all happened after the migration out of Africa. So there's no Neanderthal SNPs in the African populations. Mm-hmm. So it's really interesting to use genetics to watch the evolution of the human species and watch the way in which people migrate, and you can track migration using genetics.
Well, it was a fascinating story. Thank you so much, Dr. Roden. I really enjoyed the talk, and we had a great discussion. Look forward to seeing more. You have 7 years now before 2030 and the completion of your work.
We're getting there.
Good
thank
luck.
You very much. Okay, thank you.
Thanks for joining us on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you for asking me. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Well, you've been at the cutting edge of cardiovascular sciences, and we just heard a wonderful talk from Dr. Roden. We'll conclude now. Thank you for attending.